Queen Victoria's last visit to Brighton was in 1845, and she decided that she no longer wanted to live here. Between 1847 and 1850, and in particular 1847 and 1848, the saloon and the other rooms in the pavilion as well was stripped of its contents, most of which were removed to Kensington Palace and subsequently reinstated at Buckingham Palace, Windsor Castle and other royal palaces. This wasn't vandalism or anything sort of like that. It was because it was seriously thought the Royal Pavilion was going to be demolished, and Prince Albert and Queen Victoria wanted to reinstate some of the grand interiors that were once here in Buckingham Palace.
Various elements of the decoration were all really thought to be completely lost. The silk, it was thought the design no longer existed, and the silver wall decoration, not a fragment was known to survive. Later versions of that from the Victorian era did survive, but the original decoration wasn't really known. When these initial investigations on the apse ceiling and Robert Jones's silver leaf ceiling decoration were taken in hand, the whole idea of a major reconstruction of the decoration meant that a lot of information had to be put together.
Such a focused project permitted further treatment, so more a greater degree of restoration where there's missing parts to objects, as well as the fundamental conservation work.
And in the absence of the actual physical evidence, as I was saying, because there was so little, that really meant going to the documentary sources of evidence, the bills and contemporary descriptions and so on. So we knew a lot about what had to fit into the jigsaw.
So you'd start with the floorboards, then you'd have the skirting board, then you'd have the dado, then you'd have the filling, then you'd have the cornice, then you'd have the ceiling, then the fireplace, then the curtains, then the wall panels, then the wallpaper, then the chandelier, everything as a separate file, because the room is so complicated and so detailed. We had aquatints and watercolours and inventories that listed exactly what was in the room and visual evidence. So the background material was there, but it was the absence of money that was preventing its being carried out. And with the appointment of a new fundraising team called the Royal Pavilion Foundation, we were able to raise sufficient money to carry out a full restoration. And also, I should say, the encouragement of English Heritage, now Historic England, was very important. They really thought that a full restoration of the saloon would be a feasible project. And this restoration has been possible partly because of the number of in-house staff working on it. I mean, you know, Anne Sowden, who's now retired, devoted hours and hours and hours and hours of her time, which if we were paying for an external contractor would have sort of bankrupted the institution. She had also developed an awful lot of in-house expertise, which an outside contractor might not have. We've been very, very lucky. Lucky that we had the right staff in place at the right time. Extremely fortunate sort of concatenation of events.
Of course, whenever a decision is made, and it's never taken lightly, to reconstruct original decoration in a historic interior, you have to remember that you are in effect going to be destroying what's there already, or at least obscuring it. And in the case of the saloon, it was a rather well-loved interior. It was muted colours and a kind of faded grandeur, but it was only tenuously linked to the Robert Jones original. The alterations to a room, as I say, the big decision to change a room which has historical significance, even if it's from 1930, is a big one. Some would say that everything that's been done to a room, all the changes that have happened to it, should be considered integral to the room and therefore shouldn't be removed without very good reason, so which is why you have to think hard about these decisions. And in the case of the saloon, with these fragments of decoration which came to light, for an academic, perhaps, you might say that's sufficient to know that that sort of decoration was there. But rooms, particularly palatial rooms, aren't simply academic subjects. You know, the idea is that it's an all-enveloping experience, and that's something that can only be created really by recreating the decoration. It might be able to be done virtually these days, but the secondary advantage of doing this is that the concentration of the academic and scholarly attention that needs to be focused on the room once that decision to restore has been taken brings to light lots of other information, not just the fragmentary information that one finds in the room, but also documentary sources and other surprising sort of contemporary accounts and so forth. So it builds up this great sort of corpus of knowledge, if you like, which wouldn't have grown if one had just stopped at the point of acknowledging those fragments are there and thinking, well, we know what it would have looked like. We didn't, because there's always surprises, particularly in the way things work together. The way in which the platinum leaf of the wall reflects the crimson of the silk is something that you have to sort of see to appreciate. You have to sort of feel it. And these were sort of sensual experiences, ultimately. And that's really what one's trying to restore and conserve, I think.